Stand as I rehearse for your hearing. Jeremiah chapter 18. The word that I want to bring to us this morning is focus on the potter. Focus on the potter. Jeremiah 18. Starting with verse 1, I'll conclude with verse 6. This is what it reads, and I'll read it if you all are there. If you're there, say, I'm there, Tyrone. I'm there, Tyrone. If you're still getting there, say, wait on me. That's a whole lot of y'all. We're going to wait. Amen. We don't want to lose anybody. If you're standing next to somebody, show them where Jeremiah is. We're better together. If nothing else, point them to the table of contents. Amen. I trust that many more of you are there at Jeremiah. That's pretty much in the center of your Bible. Jeremiah chapter 18. This is what it reads, starting with verse 1. The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, arise and go down to the potter's house. And there, where? Where? At the potter's house, I will cause thee to hear. You will hear where? There. Where? At the potter's house. You're going to hear my words. Jeremiah said, guess what, y'all? Then I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he, who? The potter. He wrought a work on the wheels. You want to know about the will of God? He got us on the wheel. In the vessel that he made of clay, was marred in the hand of the potter. So he made it again. Another vessel as seemed good to who? Not your spouse, not your parents, not your critics. He made it again as it seemed good to who? The potter. To make it. Then the word of the Lord came to me saying, God is still talking to us, y'all. O house of Israel, and where you see Israel, it's the church for us. He says, O house of Israel, one house cannot I do with you as this potter, saith the Lord. Behold, as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in mine hand, O house, O church. Let the people of God say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
It's all about him.
It's all about him.
Amen.
Amen.
And amen.
Amen.
All right, y'all have a good time. I'll see y'all all next week. You may have your seats. It's not that good, y'all. It's going to be a good message, but it ain't that good. The visitor said, oh, I'm coming back to this church. That pastor right there know how to preach. He give us the word, and come on, Elder Walker, and he closes the book. Isn't that what it said? What prophet was that? It wasn't Elijah. It was, help me, y'all, Nehemiah, Ezra. It said Ezra opened the book, read from the pages, closed the book, and the people went home. We preachers are still trying to learn from Ezra today, amen? Family of God, listen to me. In the day that I just read in Jeremiah's time, the people of God, they experienced many problems. Elder Gary, much like us today. They underwent a lot of persecution, and a lot of it was by their own fault, just disobeying God. But while they were undergoing the problems and the persecutions, God raised up a prophet, we would consider today a preacher, Anthony. And he said to Jeremiah, he says, listen, I want you to do something, Jeremiah. I want you to go to the potter's house. I want to show you something there at the potter's house. And I believe God brought me here this morning to share with you all that we need to focus, calibrate our thinking, synchronize our hearts. As children of God, we're taught to walk by faith. Is that right? Amen. And not by sight. And the reason why we're told to walk by faith and not by sight is because we're not going to always see things that are good. And in some of us, even though we can see, our vision becomes blurred. We don't see it the way God sees it. But God sent me this morning to tell you what he sent Jeremiah to tell them. Focus on the potter. Because we are one house, many people may misconstrue and misinterpret what that all means. So you can come to my house, and you can come to my house to see Andrea. She lives there. You can come to my house to see my children. At times, they're home now. You can come to my house and want to walk through and peruse the rooms of the house and get excited about the furniture in the house. But if you come to my house and you never come to see me, the owner, there's a problem. We can talk about one house, and we should, because we're connected. We're better together. But this is the problem with so many of God's people. You come to the house, and you're looking at the pottery, but you're not focusing on the potter. And if you come to the house of God just to see, I'm just clay. All I am is clay. And if all you see today is Tyrone, then you missed. You've missed the point. You've missed the message. The message is, don't look at the clay. Hey, don't stare at the pottery. But look at the potter. He said, Jeremiah, go down to the potter's house. Now, you got to understand, that would be equivalent to God saying, Tyrone, go down to the Killeen Mall. Because the potter's house was nothing special to them back then. We've made it special to us now because it's in the Word of God. But what God was saying was, go down to the marketplace, and I want you to go to just somewhere that would look and seem insignificant. He says, stop by, mother. Stop by the potter's house. When you get there, though, he says, I want you to focus. So you got to be able to read between the lines. He was saying, focus on the potter. How do I know he was saying focus on the potter? Because he didn't put emphasis on the pottery. He didn't even allow Jeremiah to walk through the potter's house. He says, when you get there, tell me what you see. I see the potter. And he's working a work on the wheel. First thing we ought to understand when it comes to focusing on the potter is we got to see the potter's hands. Because the potter's hands, it represents we have the support of the potter in our misunderstandings. The potter's hand represents his strength. But he gives us his support. He gives us his hand. The potter was working on the pottery, on the wheel, and it was representing his hands was on the pottery. And his hands was able to, listen now, support the pottery, because had he put the pottery on the wheel top and not his hands, the pottery would have slid left or slid right. The pottery would not have been firm and strong. And so the first thing Jeremiah had to do was focus on the potter's hands. The potter's hands is his strength, it's his support in times of misunderstandings. Why do I say misunderstandings? Because many times we're wondering, why am I going through all of these problems? And the world would say, I don't want your God. Because if God was real, why do we have all this chaos? I'm talking about the greatest misunderstanding of them all is that God is not real because it's so bad in the world. God took Israel out of Egyptian bondage, and he used a man by Moses to deliver the message to the Pharaoh, let my people go. And as they left Egypt and were on their way to the promised land, the Bible says that the Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, his advisors came to him and said, man, are you crazy? By letting those slaves go, you just crashed our economy. That was our workforce. And the Pharaoh said, oh my, because it always boils down to money. Just like today. And the Pharaoh said, oh my, wait a minute. I got beside myself. He says, go get the chariots, go get the horses. We're going to pursue those rascals. We're bringing them back and we're going to enslave them again. And the people were following Moses, and Moses was led by God, a pillar of a cloud by day and fire by night. But then they arrived at the Red Sea. I want to talk to some people who's had, Kim, some Red Sea experiences. This is what I'm talking about. See, Red Sea experiences, those are moments in your life that you know, but know, but know without a shadow of a doubt. God did this. This didn't happen by my hand. I couldn't pull this off by myself. The Red Sea experience was them looking in front of them and seeing nothing but ocean. And they looked behind them and they saw the enemy pursuing them. And the people began to cry out. And this is what they said. They said, Moses, didn't we tell you, man, to leave us alone when we was in Egypt? Didn't we tell you we had it better here? See, some people, they think they got it better in dysfunction. Oh, I'm going to preach it. Come on now. They think that they got it better in dysfunction only because they're used to it. And what God is sending me here to tell you today, just because you're used to dysfunction, it doesn't make dysfunction better. God says you can do better. You don't have to stay in that relationship. You don't have to remain in that environment all because you're used to it. They said, Moses, we was all right where we were. Never mind that for 400 years they were crying out to God for help. But now they're facing the Red Sea before them. The enemy is pursuing behind them. And now they're telling Moses, why did you come to deliver us? We were doing better. But the Bible says, listen to this, y'all. The Bible says God, Elder Solomon, was leading them. What does that mean, Dr. Crew? When you find yourself in problems, when you find yourself beneath the pressures, understand you got God's presence. Because God led them right where they were. Now, here's the real point. If you go back and read Exodus 14, I'm telling you, it's going to blow your mind. The Bible says the reason why the Pharaoh got emboldened, the reason why the Pharaoh, Tony, thought he can chase Israel, because this was the report. They said, Pharaoh, them folks is walking around in circles. Them folks are confused. Pharaoh, they're lost. And Pharaoh said, well, because they're lost and confused, then we can catch them. But the scripture says God made Israel dally, walk in circles and appear confused and lost so he can bait the Pharaoh to come out. Right now in your life, you're confused, you're perplexed. You don't know which way is up, which way is left from your right. You're thinking, God, I'm lost. God says, you ain't lost, baby. You're right where I brought you. And I brought you here to look like you're lost so that the devil, so he can take a hit. Y'all better help me. I'm trying to calm down. All I want to do is talk to y'all. Can I just talk to y'all right now? That's all I want to do. Listen, you're not lost is all God is saying, my brother. He got you walking in circles so that the enemy can think, I got the upper hand. And just when the enemy thinks he got the upper hand, God gonna hit him with the uppercut. Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord. You just hang in there. Go ahead, my sister. You just hang in there. That's all God wants you to do. Is don't get to the point where you feel God is not with me. It says he let them out. Listen, this is what it says in Exodus 14. God let them out with a high hand, Anthony. With a what? High hand. Oh, Jesus. That caused me to go study that word. I said, what does you mean by a high hand? When I went and searched high hand, it said, James, it said that meant God let them out in confidence, in defiance. What? God was showing up the devil. God was showing up the Pharaoh. God was saying, when you leave out of here, hold your head up. And you don't have to walk in defeat, but you can walk in defiance, knowing that your God has your back. Come on now. God wants you to know that. Your God has your back. I want to calm it down because I'm telling you, I'm getting excited. I can get excited? Okay, listen. Somebody gave me permission. I remember I was talked into buying 4 new tires for my truck. And I bought these 4 new tires with the expectation that I would go all year long with no problems. Only to discover less than a month later, I caught a flat. So I took the truck back to the place, the service, and I complained to them. I said, listen, I bought 4 new tires and I was not expecting to catch a flat, say a flat. I was not expecting to catch a flat in less than a month. And this is what the guy told me at the service station. He said, Mr. Holcomb, I'm sorry, sir. He says, if anybody deceived you, I apologize. He says, but let me inform you that we don't offer guarantees. What we do give are warranties. We can't guarantee you won't catch a flat. But we will warranty when you get the flat, we can fix it. When you get the flats in life, God wants you to know he can fix it. See, God never gave you no guarantee. In fact, he did guarantee in this life you will experience tribulations. That sounds like flats to me. Now, what are flats? Flats are failures. Say failures. Failures, that's when you disappoint yourself. But then they're letdowns. Say letdowns. That's when somebody else disappoints you. But then there's agony. Say agony. Those are internal pains. But then there's trouble. Say trouble. That's problems and pains coming from the outside. And God is saying that when you have your failures, your letdowns, the agonies and the troubles. He says, don't worry, because I'm leading you out with a high hand, and I can fix all those flats. The Lord is strong. Say, the Lord is strong. And because the Lord is strong, he is able, listen now, he is able to hold all your weights. Because he's strong. I'm talking about the potter whose hands is on the pottery. Because he's strong, he's able to support your weight, but he's also able to strengthen you while you wait. If you need some strength, you need to wait on the Lord. If you're looking for some strength, you got to wait on the Lord. See, I'm talking about Jeremiah, but another prophet by the name of Isaiah, he taught us something. He says, they that wait on the Lord shall what? Renew their strength. He says, they will mount up with wings as eagles. He says, they will run and not get weary. They will walk and they will not faint. Why? Because as you wait on the Lord, he strengthens you internally. Just learn to wait on the Lord. We so caught up in society and everything being instant, everything being fast, that when God doesn't do something instantly, we think he hasn't heard our prayers. And God says, listen, true success is being developed in the process. This is why we're told, let patience have a perfect work. If you don't believe Jeremiah, and if you doubt in Isaiah, well, then we can look at Paul, and he wrote over in the book of Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 16 through 17. Paul said, at my first trial, no man stood with me. He says, in fact, all men forsook me. There's one thing that they don't show up to trial, but you can't find them anywhere. He says, all men, they left me high and dry. He says, but you know what? I'm praying that God will not lay it to their charge, that they let me down. We talking about flats. They let me down. He says, but that notwithstanding, listen to this, y'all. Even though all men forsook Paul, he said, that notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me. And while he stood with me, he strengthened me. And when he strengthened me, he says, he gave me the ability to preach. He gave me the ability to do what? Preach. See, you can't preach. You can't reach each without your own testimony. Many of you are going to go out here and say, oh, you should have heard the word Elder Tyrone preached. Oh, he brought a word from heaven. But them folks at the job going to say, well, tell me what he do for you. I know what the preacher preached, but can you preach what he did in your life? Come on, Elder Dana. And the best message you can preach is not this message. It's the message that God delivered you from some hells, from some problems. Am I right, Valon? What I'm talking about is we got to see the potter's what? His hands. Because it's in his hands that he supports us, my sister, in our misunderstandings. And the greatest misunderstanding we have is why? But then after you understand that you got God's support because the potter's hands, there's something else he wanted Jeremiah to see. What's that? The potter's hold. The potter's hold. It's one thing, Anthony, if I just come up to you, my brother, and dap you up. Good to see you, cuz. And that encourages us. You know, that brother dap me up. But it's something altogether different when I come up and when I come up and hold you, it's something that's transferable when you feel a hold. See, what the hold is representative of is God's love in our mistakes. God loves us, Sion, in our mistakes. A lot of folks would criticize Tyrone for the mistakes he made. I can't tell y'all my real testimony. Oh, no, I ain't crazy. If I gave y'all my real testimony, see, I ain't talking about that good watered-down testimonies that we be sharing with everybody. I'm talking about that testimony that brought me right here to this altar. That testimony that caused me to get on my knees. That testimony that caused the tears to run down my cheeks. See, when you hear a person's real testimony, it might scare you. I shared my testimony one time in a room full of men, and one of the brothers said, "I didn't know you was that." It didn't bother me. No, it didn't bother me. When he said, "I didn't know you was that," it didn't bother me. Because if it's going to bother you, don't share it. See, when you really get down to it and a person say, "My God, I never thought you would do that." That don't speak about Tyrone. It speaks about the power of God. Because what that tells people is, "My God, my God, my God, if he can do it for you, I know I got hope. I know I got some hope." If you an elder in the church, you walking around preaching this word like this, and you telling me you used to be that, then God, there's a chance for me. I'm talking about the God of love. See, when God saved Israel out of Egyptian bondage, he then had Moses to take Israel to a mountain called Mount Sinai. And if you spell Mount Sinai, you can't spell Sinai without running across sin. And God says, "Now, before I take you in," talking about the promised land, "before I take you in, I got to address your sin." And he gets the people to Mount Sinai, and he tells Moses, he says, "Give the people this command." And this is what he told them. This is in Exodus 19, so you can go and read it for yourself. But this is what he said to him, my brother. He says at Mount Sinai, Moses, he says, "Tell the people they got to clean up." He said, "Tell them to go wash up." Oh, my, y'all ain't no God talk like that. God says, "Tell them to wash their bodies and tell them to wash their clothes." He said, "Tell the people, William, number one, what? Wash up. Clean up your act. It's time to clean up." But then he says, "But Moses, I want you to also put a border around the mountain." Why? "I don't want them people coming up on me." All right, let me come over here. You gotta know the God we serve. Listen now, I'm talking about love right now. God said, "Moses, them people so dirty." He said, "Tell them to clean up." He said, "But put a border. I don't want them or their animals." You don't even want my dog or my cat? He said, "No, I don't want nothing to come up on me." He says, "Put a border around." And here's the last part. Now, many of us may say, "Well, Tyrone, I don't mind washing up. I like washing my clothes. And I don't mind keeping my distance when it comes to God." But here was that last commandment that shook the nation. He says, "Moses," as Moses was walking away, he said, "Give him one more command." "What's that, God?" "Tell him, don't have no sex." Ho, wait a minute. He said, "Tell the men, don't touch their wives. It's a sacred time right now." What in the world did he say? Now, I got a report to y'all, and this ain't going to be something surprising. They couldn't follow the commands. Now, listen. See, if I ain't break it down to y'all like that, many people be talking about, "Man, why they mess it up back in the day for all of us, man? Why couldn't they just do what God said?" But when you find out he said, "Listen, don't have no sex during this time." Now, some of y'all be like, "Man, look, you can keep that, brother. I ain't trying to hear that." But a lot of the folks, they missed it. Say they missed it. They had mistakes because they couldn't keep those commands. But then God came by this very prophet that I'm preaching, Jeremiah. In Jeremiah 31, God said, "Jeremiah, go back and tell the people something." I want to read it in the NIV. Listen to this. I can paraphrase it. Y'all know that. But let me read it to you. I want you to hear what God said. Listen to Jeremiah 31. "The Lord appeared to us in the past, saying," this is Jeremiah 31, verse 3. And I'm going to read verse 3, and then I'm going to skip down to verse 31 through 34. Listen to this. "The Lord appeared to us in the past, saying, I have loved you with an everlasting love." I'm talking about the potter's hold. It represents what? His love for our mistakes. We can't keep the law, God. We keep tripping up. We keep messing up. This is what God said after all of that. I loved you with an everlasting love. I have drawn you with unfailing kindness. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant. Say new covenant.
New covenant.
God says, I'm going to make a new covenant with the people of Israel, and for us it's the church, and with the people of Judah. And it will not be like the covenant, listen, I made with their ancestors. That's what we just talked about over in Exodus 19. He says, it will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the what? I told you, we just talked about the Lord's hand, his strength, his support. He says, when I took them by the hand to do what? Lead them out of Egypt. He says, because they broke my covenant, though I was their husband. He says, declares the Lord, this is the covenant I will make with the people of Israel, subsequently the church, after that time, declares the Lord. Now listen to this. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God. They will be my people. No longer will they teach their neighbor or say to one another, know the Lord, because they all will know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. Now, all of this new covenant is incumbent upon. It's resting upon this last statement. Don't miss it. For I will forgive their wickedness, and I will remember their sins no more. My friends, please don't miss this. The love of God, he said, I know in the beginning I laid a hard commandment on y'all. He gave them the Ten Commandments in Exodus chapter 20, and then he even gave them, listen now, he gave them 603 more commandments, 613 commandments in all. And the people said, we can't bear this. We can't keep this. And God came back, Travis, through the prophet Jeremiah, and God said, listen, I know what I gave y'all was difficult. He says, but because I love you, I gave you that just to show you you can't do it without me. I never anticipated y'all keeping all those covenants, all those commandments. Annette, he says, but now, Jeremiah, tell the people, because of my love, I've made a new covenant. Now, here's the point. See, in the old covenant, you had to hold on to it. But with the new covenant, it's going to hold on to you. What do I mean by it's going to hold on to you? He says, I'm giving you my promise. I'm never going to stop being your God. You're never going to stop being my people. And to put all of that together and wrap it with a bow, he says, this is why my promise will sustain, because I've already decided, Jesse, to forgive you. I'm going to forgive you. Oh, God, you don't know. Nobody knows what I did. Nobody knows what I done last night. Remember that old movie, that horror flick? I know what you did last summer. My brother God said, I know what you did last night. And he says, but I've already forgiven you. Psalms 103 says it this way. As far as the east is from the west, God says, that's how far I removed your sin from you. Now, you have to be able to understand direction to appreciate what he just said. He didn't say as far as the north is from the south, because the north and the south, they have poles, which means they can be measured. But you don't have no east and west poles. Why? Because it's immeasurable. The east and the west shall never meet. And God says, as far as the east is from the west and they never meet, he says, your sins will never come back to haunt you again. I won't hold your sins against you. I'm talking about love for your mistakes. I remember back in the 90s, in the mid-90s, this is well before I was ordained to be an elder. And I was sitting in a Sunday night service. Yeah, that's right. We used to have Sunday night services. Some of y'all saying, God is good. And in the Sunday night service, at this particular point, we had a brother, a dear brother. He's gone on since to be with the Lord. But Jerome Lee, he was there playing the saxophone. And we were listening to this brother minister to us during the service. And a particular brother came in late, and he sat down next to me. And he began to share with me his problems that he was having at home. And I was kind of, you know, put off and thinking, brother, this ain't the time. But then my heart went out. I said, no, let me go ahead and share it with the brother. I said, brother, you in the house of God. Whatever's taking place back home, don't worry about it. You're in the house of God right now. And while I was sharing with the brother, hey, just focus, focus, focus. I always talk about focus, right? I said, just focus, focus, focus. Well, Bishop had got up. My father, for those of you who don't know, he used to be the pastor of the Christian House of Prayer. At the time, he was the pastor. Bishop Nate Holcomb, he got up from his seat, and he began to walk up the aisle. And as he was walking up the aisle, he and I made eye contact while I was talking to the brother, encouraging the brother, Mike. And I said, oh, my God. Bishop going to think I'm in here talking in service. So now I had to make a quick decision. Do I just shut up and ignore this brother's problems? Or do I just finish what I was saying to him? And I chose to finish, y'all. And as I was finishing what I was saying, Bishop was now behind me, and I can feel like x-ray vision going through me. And I was thinking, oh, my God, I can't wait for service to be over, and I'm going to hit a beeline to my car. And when the service was complete, I did just that. I got up, and I was going out to my car. And you may not remember this, but Elder Joe Walker, you came out, saw me in the foyer. We was in Coppers Cove, and you said, hey, Tyrone. Hey, Bishop want to see you in his office. God dog it. And Joe walked back and held the glass door open for me. I'm looking at Joe like, man, Benedict Arnold, man, you ain't gonna tell him you saw me, brother. I walks in and Bishop's walking around, man. You know how Bishop, he walk, he cool. And I'm feeling like all of a sudden, I must have been about maybe 24, 25. I'm feeling like a little kid going to see the principal. And I'm trying to tell myself, Tyrone, man, be quick, ye like men. Get brave. Don't be afraid. None of it was working. I walked in there, and everybody was giving Bishop stuff, and Bishop, yeah, And he looked at me, and he said, yeah, I'll see you in the office, son. And I said, oh, my God. I said, where be the God of Abraham? And I'm sitting in the office, and I can hear Bishop out there. He's laughing. He's joking. I said, maybe it's not what I think. He's having a good time. And then all of a sudden, Bishop came in the office, and he slammed the door, and he sat down, and he looked at me, and he said, let me tell you something. I said, ho, dad. He said, what's up? What's up? I said, dad, before you say anything, sir, can we start off with a word of prayer? This is real talk. This is real talk. I said, can we start off with a word of prayer? And you know what Bishop did? Bishop said, go ahead, pray. And I bowed my head, and I said, dearest Heavenly Father, we humbly come to you, dear Father, with thanksgiving, thanking you for your mercies. For they adore, they endure, they endure. And when I looked up with the, in Jesus' name, amen. And I drew back, Bishop never bowed his head. He never closed his eyes. He looked at me and said, you finished? And I said, what in the world? And Bishop said, let me tell you something, son. Don't you ever disrespect God in this house. When we having service, this, that, and the third. And I said, well, dad. He said, no, let me tell you something, son. He says, you're going to have to learn that you don't play in God's house. And when he got through, I said, dad, listen, all I'm saying is the brother, he sat down next to me, and he began to share his woes and so forth and so on. He said, that's what counseling is for. I said, well, I was counseling him. He said, not in God's house, not at that time, just that and the third. And he said, this is what he said. He said, Tyrone, can you receive? You missed it. He said, "You missed the mark." And he started pounding his fist in his other hand. And he said, "Can you receive? You missed the mark." And I'm telling y'all, I got Holy Ghost help all of a sudden. I looked him in his eyes and I said, "Dad, I can receive that I missed the mark. If you can receive, at least I was aiming for it." That was some Holy Ghost help right there, y'all. When I said that, this is the truth. Bishop's countenance changed. His shoulders went from tense to relaxed. And Bishop looked at me and he said, "Son, I know you hear from God, because I ain't taught you that." And then he shook my hand. Now, what was he talking about? Listen to me, y'all. What was he talking about? "I know you hear from God, because I ain't taught you that." And he shook my hand. What Bishop recognized is the room went from law. It went from the law. "You've missed it. You made a mistake. Can you receive? You missed the mark." It went from law to grace. Now, I know that we've been given definitions of grace. Grace is God's power and equipment for ministry. The sonship graduates, y'all know that. We've heard that grace is God's riches at Christ's expense. But let me introduce, if you did not know, God's grace is his love. God's grace says, even when you miss it, I still love you. I'm still on your side. I will be your God. You will be my people. God is the great director. And as the great director, he's writing all of our scripts. Now, I love watching a good movie. I don't know if I got movie buffs out here, but me and my daughter Ty, we like a good movie. Is that right, Ty? Now, what makes a good movie, you got to start with a good director. Now, I got some of my favorites. You know, I like the Ron Howard movies, the Martin Scorsese's. I like Steven Spielberg. He got a good imagination. I like several directors in their movies, but let me introduce to you this director, and we've all heard of his name, Tyler Perry. Now, say what you want about Tyler Perry. I personally don't get off on Tyler Perry's movies. There's one movie that I said, Tyler Perry hit it with that one. It's called The Jazz Man's Blues. I gave him a good pub on that. Go home, Netflix, Jazz Man's Blues. You wouldn't think Tyler Perry directed it. Okay, I'm sorry, Tyler. But here's my point. What I love about Tyler Perry is whatever you think about his movies, he writes them. They critique him for that. They say, you don't have writers. He writes his own movies. He directs them. But you know what I love most about Tyler Perry? He gets in them. Tyler Perry gets in a lot of his movies. Y'all know the most famed one is Madea, but he gets in his movies. Why do I say that? You got to have a love for it. You got to be totally invested in it. It's one thing for me to direct it, but I tell you then, hey, you go ahead and you play in it. But if I say I'm going to get in it with you, I'm invested. I'm talking about the Potter's Hold. God loves us so much that he wrote the story. And after he wrote the story, God says, I'm going to direct it. You may think you're running and spinning out of control. God says, no, I put that in the script. I'm going to direct it. But because he loves us so much, God said, by Jesus Christ, I'm going to come down and I'm going to get in it with you. And the reason why Jesus got in it with us, Gloria, mouth, so he can touch us. I'm talking about the God, the Potter, who wants to hold. He wants to hold you, my friend. He wants to touch you, Bobby, because he loves you. Don't forget that God, in his infinite wisdom, he brought together his great wrath and his great love. by putting Christ on the cross. His great wrath, because as the judge, he has to judge sin. That's his great wrath, and it was ugly on that cross. But his great love was, you don't have to do it. You don't have to get up under my great wrath. He says, I'm going to send Jesus. And Jesus is going to volunteer, send me a body so that I may go. I want to close with one more aspect about the potter that we have to consider. And that aspect is the potter's, we talked about his hand being on us and his hold. But I want to conclude with his healing water. His healing. Many of us been brokenhearted, but this is what it said, D. As the potter was working on the wheel, he noticed that the clay on Vicky was marred. The pottery was broke. Michelle, I don't know if you ever heard it this way, but the potter specialized in working on crackpots. Listen, I'm a crackpot. And I don't mind admitting it to y'all. I'm a crackpot. And if you don't know you're a crackpot, you cracked in the worst way. It's starting with your head. See, we all are crackpots, but the thing about the cracks is they give us character. And this is what I love now. It says, and when the potter was on the wheel working and he noticed that the pottery was marred, that meant it was cracked, it says he picked that pot up and threw it in the pile. No. It says he worked on it and made it again another. He used the same clay, but he made it another. He forms us in such a beautiful way. If we would just stay on the wheel. Don't get off the wheel. Because he specialized with working with what? Crackpots. Now, as I was studying this, I want them to show you. This two artists, they got together and they started doing artwork. A man by the name of Tim Noble and Sue Webster. And in their artwork, they started taking trash. And they would take trash that was, keep it up there. You don't have to see me. I want them to see that. Keep that up there. They started taking trash, and they took trash that had holes in it, that was crushed. Life has a way of crushing us. When you look at this trash up there, you see it's torn, it's tattered, it's ripped. It looks ruined. It looks like trash, does it not? But you gotta understand that these artists, what they did was they took these cans, they took this trash, and they didn't just place it on the table. They didn't place it there. You know what they did? They positioned. It's a difference. They positioned it on the table. That Pepsi can is exactly where it's supposed to be. That Coca-Cola is exactly where it's where it needs to be. And right now, as we look at this display, all we see is trash until they shine light on it. Show the next video. When you shine light, what's seen in the background, what's in the backdrop of our lives, is an awesome city. And that awesome city would not be what it is if not for two reasons. One, it needs that trash. It needs that trash to be positioned. You see those two twin towers? You see the twin towers now, but before the light shined on it, all you saw was just two cans that happened to be placed on the table. But no, they had to be positioned. And that is possible because of the positioning of what we would have deemed trash. But then this part is very important because of the lighting. Without the lighting, you never would see the finished product. And God is saying to you, what people have considered to be trash, some have told you you're going to amount to nothing. Some have said you're good, but you're good for nothing. And God is the God who specializes in crackpots. God says, I'm going to take your cracks. I'm going to take what others thought to be ruins. He says, and I'm going to position you in such a way. You're not lost. You're not wandering. So stop wondering. And know that God's hand is on your life. I want to close with this account. This particular person in the Bible has always been a blessing to me. And it's Mephibosheth. Mephibosheth was the son of Jonathan, the prince, and the grandson of the first king of Israel, Saul. Why do I say that? He was born into royalty. However, something tragic took place. And in one battle, Mephibosheth, while he was around 6 to 8 years old, Mephibosheth, he lost his grandfather, who was the king, and his father, who was the prince, in one battle. And the people of Israel heard about the loss. And Mephibosheth's nurse, in haste, in fear, she grabbed the young boy up and went to run to hide him, to protect him. But in her running, she stumbled and dropped him. And the Bible said he became lame in both feet. He became a cripple in life. And then another man by the name of David, he took over the kingdom. And David, by the unction of the Holy Spirit and by the love of God, David said, before I start to reign, is there anybody in the house, in the family of Saul, left that I can show kindness to? And a man by the name of Ziba, he came up and said, yeah, there is a young boy, Saul's, his grandson, Mephibosheth. He says, but he's crippled. Why do I mention that? Because here God is saying, I'm going to bless you. And all God is looking for is a candidate for his blessing. But some people, rather than bringing up the candidate, they bring up your condition. They say, oh yeah, God, you know who this is. That's the woman who had babies out of wedlock. Oh, you know who this guy is. He was the swindler. He was the cheater. He was the womanizer. You know who that person is. You couldn't trust them for nothing. You know about that person. They had a business several times, and every time they went out of business. You just can't depend on this person. You got people who like to bring up your condition. And God, like David said, I didn't ask you about their condition. I'm just asking for a candidate. Are you God's candidate? You got to know that you're God's candidate. Now, David sent, listen to me now, David sent men to bring Mephibosheth out of a place called Lodabar. And when I studied it, Lodabar meant a place of no pasture. Brother, it meant a place of no communication. Some of us, we have been silenced by life's tragedies. We don't know how to articulate our pain no more. And Mephibosheth was in this place. He was in this place of no communication. Some of us, we can't talk to our spouses. We can't relate to our children. Because like Mephibosheth, we've been in a place of no communication for too long. But David said, bring him out of Lodabar. Bring him to Jerusalem, the house of God. And when he got to David, Mephibosheth said, why are you sending for me? I'm just a dead dog. Can you believe that? Rather than simply saying, Al, thank you. Some folk are in the house of God saying, you ain't talking about me, preacher. I hear everybody getting excited, but surely you ain't referring to me. Why? I'm just a dead dog. Now, although Mephibosheth put himself down, David didn't care what Mephibosheth was saying. Do you know why he didn't care, Elder Solomon? Because he didn't call for Mephibosheth because of Mephibosheth, D. He says, is there anybody left in the house of Saul that I can bless for Jonathan, my good friend Jonathan's sake? You can say what you want to say about you, just don't talk bad about Jesus. Because the only reason why you getting this kind of grace, the only reason why you getting this kind of love, ain't because of your merits, ain't because of your credit, ain't because of your report, it's because of what God has done. And God says, you get in. As I close, he restored. This is with the hold. This is with the healing. It does. It restores us through our misfortunes. It restores us. Because he told Mephibosheth, no longer will you be regular, but I'm restoring you back to royalty. He says, I'm going to give you all the land that your grandfather, King Saul, possessed. That was a lot of land. He says, I'm going to give you servants that's going to gather your crops, clean up your houses. But he says, and this is the best thing of all, he says, but I'm going to have you come sit at my table every night. Mephibosheth, you will sit at my table because you will be my son. Now, I'm thinking, God, you're awesome. Because you didn't tell Mephibosheth, who's crippled, he's still crippled. You didn't tell Mephibosheth, I'm going to have you come and stand with us. He says, no, I'm going to make sure everybody else sit down with you. Won't nobody see your condition when you're around me. God says, whenever you're around me, Mephibosheth, won't nobody see your condition any longer. No longer will they be focused on the trash on the table, because I'm going to shine my light up on you. And they're going to see the image in the background. My friends, all I want you to do as we close out is when you come to the potter's house, don't focus on the pottery. Don't even focus on the house. But make sure every time you get up and come out, you come with the intent to focus on the potter. The potter's hands will support you. The potter's hold will display his love. And the potter's healing will continue to restore you. Don't give up on God, because I promise you, he will never, ever give up on you. Give God praise.